Welcome to the module 4 of week 5. We are still looking at the problem of loaded string, by which I mean particles string together or connected together in some way, and here we have taken string as a kind of abstract notion that couples particles together. So, we had already seen this problem for the last 3 or so modules, and we wrote down an equation of motion, we solved the equation of motion, we looked at the case when there are n particles tied together by a string and between two rigid walls, and we saw that if you have n particles, there would be n normal mode frequencies, and we also saw qualitatively to some extent and also quantitatively as to what kind of pattern of oscillation would be exhibited by the normal modes, especially for the lowest frequency and for the highest frequency. In cases where you have smaller number of particles, you can work out all the details and you can basically write down the pattern of oscillation for each and every case. Now, we take the next step towards what would be called the continuum limit. Here is a canonical example of what we have been seeing all along, n particles in a string, and there are these boundary conditions that the particle at the 0th position and the one at n plus 1th position, their amplitudes are 0 at all times, which means that they will not oscillate at all. Now, when I say that I am going to take the continuum limit, what I am going to do is that this distance between two particles, which we had called A, and all the particles did maintain equal distance from each other, which is equal to A. I am going to take the limit of A tending to 0. So, if I take the limit of A tending to 0, so the particles are going to come closer and closer to one another and would essentially form a string. So, that is the kind of scenario that we will be looking at. So, now we do not have to anymore worry about particles tied to a string and so on. We will just be looking at oscillations of the string itself, in which the particles are so close to each other that you can take the distance between the particles to be equal to approximately 0. To analyze this situation, we will again start from the equation of motion that we already obtained. In this equation of motion, just to recall what we had done, T is the uniform tension in the string, M is mass of the beads, and A is of course the distance between the particles. We have equation for YR, which would mean that it is the displacement for rth particle. Okay. So, R, to remind you again, is the index for the number of the particle along the string. In general, as we can see, the displacement is actually a function of both position and time. So, it depends on where you are looking at along the string and also the time. So, when we discretize, I am going to use new set of notations. So, I am going to say that A will be denoted by delta x, and of course, we will be taking the limit delta x tending to 0. So, let us say R is index for one particle, position of one particle, and now that is going to be denoted by y of x comma t. So, now explicitly it is very clear that y being the displacement depends both on space, that is the position of the particle along your string, and time. If this is the case, then I can denote few other quantities with respect to y. Since y is a function of both x and t, I can define dou y by dou x, which is partial derivative of y with respect to x or with respect to position. So, it is a question about how, what is the rate of change of the displacement as a function of the position along the string. So, when you do this, you keep t constant. Similarly, I can also define another partial derivative with respect to time. So, that would be dou y by dou t. So, y itself is a function of x and t. So, dou y by dou t would imply that it is the rate of change of displacement as a function of time when you keep x constant. So, now let us go back to our notations that we had introduced. So, we said that y r of t is y x comma t. So, this is a notational change in the continuum limit, and I am going to introduce y r plus 1 of t, which we had used, and that will become y of x plus delta x comma t, and similarly y r minus 1 of t would become y of x minus delta x as a function of time. Now, to actually obtain an equation of motion in the continuum limit, all I need to do is to substitute these things in the equation that I have, which is this. I should also mention that second derivative is also defined in a very similar way. So, d square or dou square y by dou t square would simply mean second derivative of y with respect to time when x is kept constant and so on. Okay. So, it is a standard generalization. If you are already aware of partial derivative and partial differentiation, this should be easy. In case you are not familiar with this idea of partial differentiation, I urge you to go back and look up any basic book on calculus where you should be able to easily pick up these ideas. Now, let us go ahead and let us substitute for all these yrs, yr, yr plus 1 and yr minus 1. Before I substitute, let me make an approximation here. Of course, yr is y of x comma t, quite standard, there is nothing to approximate, but yr plus 1, which is y of x plus delta x, and I am going to suppress this time here for now, but keep in mind that y always depends on time, okay, even if I do not mention it explicitly here. So, delta x being small, I can now make a Taylor expansion of this quantity about x. So, once again let me also remind you that in case you are not very familiar with the idea of Taylor expansion, please go back and look up any analysis calculus books from where you can again pick up the basic ideas easily. So, here I am Taylor expanding about x. So, in other words, the question is, I know the value of y, the displacement at position x. I want to know what is the value of displacement at a point a little bit away from x, maybe x plus dx. So, then we make a Taylor expansion. So, this will be y of x plus dou y by dou x into delta x plus 1 by 2 factorial dou square y by dou x square into delta x square plus, of course, there will be higher order terms, higher order in delta x. So, there will be term which will have some coefficient times delta x cube, some coefficient times delta x power 4 and so on. But since we have assumed that delta x is small, so it is equivalent to saying that delta x is much less than 1, in which case we can ignore all the terms which are higher order in delta x beyond delta x square. So, now before substituting in this equation, I am going to also do the same thing for y r minus 1. So, again it is a straightforward Taylor expansion, it will be y of x so it will be y of x minus delta x and it is also a function of time so it will be y x minus dou y by dou x into delta x plus 1 by 2 factorial dou square y by dou x square into delta x square and of course there are higher order terms which I am going to ignore. So, now I have all the ingredients and I will substitute all this in this equation. Now, if I do that, this is what I should get. Y r is simply y of x comma t. So, I should have on the left hand side dou square y by dou t square and it is a function of x and t. And then there is t by m a. And now, I will substitute for y r plus 1 which is y of x plus dou y by dou x into delta x plus 1 by 2 into dou square y by dou x square into delta x square. So, I am not going to consider any terms beyond this minus 2 y r will be 2 into y of x comma t. And then I have plus y r minus 1 which would give me y of x minus delta y by delta x into delta x plus 1 by 2 dou square y by dou x square to delta x square. Now, if you look at this equation, there will be many terms that cancel. So, for example, this y of x and minus 2 y of x that will cancel and so the first order term in delta x dou y by dou x into delta x will also cancel. So, after these cancellations we are only left with two terms which are the second derivative terms second derivative with respect to position x. So, let us collect all that together and write it. So, when I do all this the equation is sort of reasonably simple and I get this equation that I have in front of you. Now, of course, I should have done this long back. So, we said that A is equal to delta x. So, this would be T by m into delta x dou square y by dou x square into delta x square. So, delta x this would cancel and there would be only one delta x left here and with this I will have t divided by m by delta x multiplied with dou square y by dou x square and m by delta x of course is the linear density. So, the final result would turn out to be t by rho into dou square y by dou x square. So, now we can write the final result. So, now we have obtained an equation of motion in the continuum limit and should keep in mind that y is a function of x and t. And when we say that we are going to solve this equation, this continuum version of this equation, we mean that we should be able to obtain displacement both as a function of position and as a function of time. So, this is probably one of the most important equations in physics and is called the wave equation. The problem was to describe the dynamics of a collection of particles which are coupled together, and there may be a boundary condition, there may not be a boundary condition, it is not particularly important as far as the equation of motion itself is concerned. So, we were able to obtain an equation of motion whose discrete form was this, given right in front of you. So, physically this corresponds to beads which are tied together by strings. Now, when you bring those beads closer and closer together, you get to the continuum limit. So, you take the limit properly starting from that discrete version of your equation of motion, you will end up with a partial differential equation, and this is called the wave equation. And as again I would like to emphasize that here there is no boundary condition imposed in this equation. So, every time we solve a problem, we need to impose a boundary condition suitable for that problem. So, with this lesson I will stop this module, and we will look at how to solve the wave equation and various properties of this and how it relates to real physics of the problem in the next week.